I'm good. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. Welcome to our October 12th Board of Douglas County Commissioners work session. I'm just going to kick it over to Sarah to give us a few bits of information.
Commissioners, we're going to have just as a reminder for the public, anybody who might be watching or listening, that this is for informational purposes only, and we don't take any action at these. And we're real excited to have this update with Kim Kreiner, Ritchie, and her team. So Kim, I'm just going to turn it over to you, and you can introduce your team and kick us off.
Okay, thank you. So we've been looking forward to this for a while. Our office has changed a bit, and we have a lot of stuff going on, and so we're glad for this opportunity to come and tell you as much as we can in a short amount of time, so that hopefully we can get through some information and we can hear your questions. And you know, we're a new Douglas County focused office, and so we want to also hear what your sustainability priorities are as well. So I'm going to spend some time to start us off to introduce my team, and you're going to hear from each one of them today, but I just wanted to kick that off. As you know, that the joint Lawrence Douglas County Sustainability Director position has been dissolved, and we now have two distinct sustainability offices in our community. And when that decision was made, the remaining staff and the administration said, okay, if we had a county-focused sustainability office, what should it look like? How can we think about distributing our staff talents and resources in a way that's really going to benefit the county's needs? So with that, we have Jamie Hoffling. Jamie came to work for the county through a grant related to food waste reduction. We also quickly snagged her talents and knowledge of energy systems to help us with stages of our climate action plan. And Jamie's food waste grant, which you'll hear about in a moment, ended last month. So we actually had very fortuitous timing to be able to hang on to her and make her permanent staff now as an analyst, working with our climate action plan development and later with implementation of that. We have Amut Bayramalu. She joined us in March. She is also provided to us through a federal grant. She is our urban agriculture pro, and we'll hear about the exciting stuff going on with Common Ground in her management. And then Connie has been moved into a new role, slightly new role, a food system specialist, where she is focusing on supporting the Food Policy Council and implementation of the food system plan. And Connie's been working with us in our office, starting at an intern level for about 2 years, but her history with our work goes back to her service on the Food Policy Council and then all the way back to the development of the food system plan itself. So she may tell us more about that later as well. And then there's me. And I will be focusing on large-scale planning countywide, including open space and climate action. And I also highly anticipate that my capacity will be well-utilized, keeping an eye on recovery opportunities and funding that's coming down to help us launch and implement some of the strategies that are gonna come out of these two plans. In fact, I think we're gonna have a really interesting balancing act of planning and implementing, maybe simultaneously, because we know these plans are really important to lay out the work for us that's coming, but we also can't let these opportunities pass us by. So we'll be coming to you with some interesting, exciting stuff, I'm sure. So the open space plan has been a long time coming. This is a team effort of sustainability, zoning and codes, and heritage conservation. I'm very happy to tell you that we are, this team is in deliberation over two really excellent candidates to consult us through this process. So we anticipate that we will be hitting the ground running with them as soon as this month, maybe November, But this is a 18-month timeline that we're working on, and we'll wrap up hopefully on the early side of 2024. We do have some ARPA funds that we are really excited to implement, to apply toward implementation of open space. And this will be one of those simultaneous strategy things where we're planning, but we're also looking for the things that we can do right now. Oh, forgive me.
I know I kept
thinking. God, why didn't you?
Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't want to interrupt you.
Natalie is our distinguished intern, who I was actually planning on shouting out when I got to the data portion of our climate action plan. However, I wasn't. Long story, we kind of only invited her at the last minute, which was our bad. So my whole exciting spiel, I'm sorry. I guess she didn't have your picture. All right.
We'll get it added.
Okay. We're so lucky. We're so lucky to have Natalie. I'm so glad you did. We're so lucky to have Natalie. Just call, interrupt me if I'm missing something.
I will. Now I've got permission.
Okay. Okay, and our open space plan is certainly going to intersect with our underdevelopment climate plan our climate plan is going to, sorry, lost my space for a minute. Having forgotten Natalie, it intersects in the ways that land can help us manage the impacts of climate change. And so we'll be looking for those opportunities. So the climate plan, which was called for in Plan 2040, is being developed as an action and adaptation plan in that it is going to address strategies for reducing greenhouse gases, but also helping our community to be more resilient to the risks that we're still gonna face. Forgive me. Okay, so I wanna acknowledge that this effort has been a winding path, disrupted by both a pandemic and an office restructure. But despite those things, we've continued to prioritize interdepartmental buy-in, alignment with established commitments, and stories of lived experience.
Kim, if I can ask, is it a countywide climate action plan or is it a city-county plan?
That's a great question. So when we launched this in 2020, you made me think of something else that I was forgetting, is that we are heavily working with the new sustainability director, Kathy Richardson, for the city of Lawrence on this project. She is a strong partner in this project. This project is... It started as a Lawrence Douglas County plan, but we didn't want to eliminate the opportunity that the other cities in our community may wish to adopt this plan, be part of this plan. And so we're just broadened it just to Douglas County generally. And we have staff from our other three cities who are serving on our staff advisors for this. And we hope that they'll incorporate this plan hope it'll be a plan that their community wants to invest in because they helped develop it, and that it will be something that they incorporate into their work as much as they wish. So did that answer the question? But being our other sustainability staff in the county, again, the city of Lawrence remains a very heavy partner. Forgive me. Okay, so I just mentioned lived experience and public outreach. So in 2021 and 2022, early 2022, we conducted community learning that involved surveys that connected climate to people's everyday lives, and story collection with particular focus on audiences that are identified as vulnerable, particularly to climate change. And the results of these items, the synthesis of these items are publicly available on our project website, which I'd be happy to give you more access to if that was something of interest. As I just mentioned, we have a team of staff advisors. So we've convened this team from members of all the governments, many departments across in the county government, many departments in the city of Lawrence government, to help ensure that our resulting plans are aligning and enhancing with existing community commitments and not leaving them out. And we have a steering committee made up of community members and organization representatives that are also helping to guide the process, representing sectors from housing to transportation, mental health, for example, and many others. So that brings us to where we are on our timeline with this project. So I just, you know, described that we did some initial outreach, have convened more advisors, and throughout the fall, we are going to be addressing some of the gaps that we saw in the analysis of our initial outreach, to make sure that this really is a community built plan and that we're hearing from different parts of our community, not only priority populations, but also geographically. We are spending intention this fall to make sure that we are listening and learning from the other three cities in our county and the unincorporated area, three smallest cities in our county. And with that, I will turn it over to Jamie to talk about what's coming up next with this plan.
Okay, so as Kim mentioned, we did extensive community research. We did the community survey and we reached 600 plus people through that. And we did the community narratives by hiring community coordinators to go out and learn from people who were identified as being the most vulnerable in our community to climate change, to the impacts of climate change. And through that, through the results of looking at those results, we realized that there are certain groups that really needed to be spoken to that had not been reached yet. So we've been building a list of those, and they're on the next slide. If I could just, you're fine. Your job's not over. So this is a list. We've got first responders. That's coming up first. So on Thursday next week, over the lunch hour, tomorrow, I'll be gone next week. It's tomorrow. It's right at the Flory building. We're meeting with first responders, and we have many members from the fire department. We have LPD. We have fire departments from Eudora that will be represented there. I think there's about 12 or so that are signed up for it. So we're going to get to hear from them. They're going to be arranged in a way that we're going to have information, just a little bit of background taken from the regional vulnerability assessment. It's actually called the climate and vulnerability. I'm forgetting the name of it. Climate and risks vulnerability assessment that was done for the region. So Douglas County was included in that. And we're going to share just a little bit of background just to kind of help them see what was identified in that assessment, where we're seeing the most extreme weather events and or which ones we're seeing as most common and that are going to have the highest consequences. So that'll be part of that. And then each one of these focus groups will be tailored to that specific group. So we'll have a series of those throughout the fall. And go ahead and do the next slide. I am going to switch now rapidly to something very different. And this is the grant that Kim mentioned early on when she was introducing us that brought me into the office. So it was a grant. We were one of 13 communities that was grant funded by the USDA as part of their food waste reduction and recovery grants. And we decided to do ours in two parts. So we ran two different programs to try to reduce food waste in Douglas County. And we started by recovering or establishing a gleaning operation, which is essentially recovering unsellable produce from farms and then turning that around and donating that to the different pantries in the area. So we worked with Sunrise Project and Just Food, and Catholic Charities also came into the fold later, and Just Food services more than 30 agencies in the area. So that food that we gleaned went far and wide. And I do have a slide in a minute that I'll share that gives you how far we got with that, just how many pounds we were able to glean. And then the other part of that was to work with the City of Lawrence Municipal Services and Operations to try out or pilot adding food waste to their yard waste facility. So if you use their facility for taking any yard waste, they compost that. They wanted to try out adding food scraps to that as well. So we also did that. It was a two-year grant, and Kim mentioned earlier, it just wrapped up last month. So the next slides will show the results. So for the gleaning operation, in our first year, we far exceeded what we had projected. We got 18,000 pounds. I think we had closer to 14,000. No, it was like 1,000. It's right there. 1,000 pounds of produce is what we thought we were going to get per month. We ended up with 18,000 for the whole year, which was amazing. And it was with the help of course, all of our farmers and throughout Douglas County, and with all the volunteers. There, we have a list of like 200 people who wanted to sign up and glean with us. It was amazing. Second year was really good too. Farmers did have some added challenges. So the growing season started a little bit later. I don't know if any of you grow food. I think you mentioned, my tomatoes are still green on my vine. So we started a lot later. And so right now there's 13,000 pounds, but we're transitioning, or we have effectively transitioned this program to after the harvest. So Douglas County will no longer be in charge of it, but we'll still work in concert with after the harvest as much as we need to. They're a Kansas City-based nonprofit that's been doing gleaning for, I think, going on 10 years now. And they've been wonderful to work with. They've been with us right from the beginning. Kim met them and right away got us set up with them. So it's the reason why we were so successful in the program. It really was their help. And it's been amazing to be able to transition it to them and know that it's in good hands. So I expect those numbers to probably surpass 18,000 by the end of this year. So we'll have that coming. Let's go ahead and do the next slide. And then on the compost side, we hit the ground running and we ended up with 24,000 pounds of food waste that was collected at Just Foods. We had a hopper sitting out, or a bin sitting outside their facility, and we were collecting the food scraps there. Just Food does, they do what they can with all of the food that comes into their facility, but sometimes there's food that just can't be eaten. They'll get big cases of avocados that are already spoiled, and nobody wants to eat a spoiled avocado. So those things end up in the bin and they get composted. And we were really successful with that in the first year. The second year, the reason why you have this lovely picture of the hogs eating food scraps down there is because we moved up the EPA food recovery hierarchy, and we stopped composting it because Just Food was able to divert that food waste over to hog farms. So you can see that we have a big zero for the second year. There wasn't any food scraps collected this year. This pilot has wrapped up, and we shared as much as we could with the City of Lawrence. And we look forward to working with them in the future on the climate action plan and take what we learned together through that pilot, including the gleaning, to move forward with the climate action plan. Oh, and I don't want to forget to say that with the food waste, you might wonder what we did with all the food waste that was composted. We did end up with several yards of, with that 25,000 pounds of, 23,500 pounds of food waste that was composted. All of that was provided to community gardens. And I'm hoping that most of the last remaining piles of that ended up with Amu, which she'll talk about, I'm sure, in her presentation. Thank you.
Jamie, can you talk a little bit? I probably should know this, put it out. How is it better to go to feeding livestock, right, than it is for compost? You know, because I can imagine some members of the public would say, well, wait, it went to lot. We could have used that compost to grow garden. Can you just talk about why you made that choice and how that impacts our food systems?
That is a really good question and a little bit hard to answer. The hierarchy comes from the EPA, and I don't know if I could tell you exactly why they came up with it the way that they did, but they do say first you prevent your food waste. That's where you want to start. And then the next tier down from that is to feed people. And then they put feeding animals next, and then compost. And I don't know if you want to say a little bit more about reasons why that might be.
So I don't have the research in front of me or anything, but if you think about the resources that go into feeding animals. So if you think we have to look at the whole life cycle of the material. So we're taking the resources from where they could have been dirt, and now they're being food. We're now offsetting all the food that we needed to feed that animal, or whatever percentage. You know, we don't need the land to grow the food. We don't need to, spend the time on the food. We don't need to, whatever goes into feeding pigs or hogs. So I think that there's a lot into that life cycle portion of it.
Yeah.
I have a follow-up question to that, just because I do find it interesting. I heard you mention that Just Food is diverting it. Is that sort of a directive that they get as a food bank and sort of their regulations about how they divert their food waste? And that's sort of maybe what triggered the change.
Yeah, and that's really important, I think, to point out too. It wasn't actually a decision that we made internally. I shared this because I find it just kind of serendipitous that happened and that it matches up with the EPA's food hierarchy. But that was a decision that Just Food made alone without our input on that. From my understanding and my experience of being at Just Food and spending time with them, they have a lot of donations that come in through their warehouse, and it's a gift for them to be able to give something back. And so I think that's part of it, was they were able to give that food waste to those hog farms and that, so that they can, you know, donate in the future.
Can I ask a question? So how did the city of Lawrence feel about the composting part of it? Was that successful for them? I know this was a pilot project. Is it something that they'd be interested in doing in the future, or is it a lot more trouble to handle a product that they don't normally handle?
Yeah, that's a really good question too, and also a little challenging to answer. Kind of would like to have them here to answer that appropriately.
I do think that we would need city staff to appropriately address that. Oh, yeah, make that connection.
I think just kind of closing that loop up, that piece of like, if how the, I mean, I know that there were some struggles with how it went. So maybe just reporting back out on that piece back to, if you could, Kim, we could get that back.
Yeah, just kind of to, you know, close the loop with, here was the pilot project to try this out. And was it sustainable from the city's perspective in terms of how much effort that they had to put into it? So that's, I'm curious to that.
You can answer that?
But I'll try. They were, it was very limited in what they wanted to experiment with. It was fruit and veggies only. And there wasn't enough funding in the grant, nor did the city of Lawrence have funding to support transportation beyond Just Food. So there was only the one stream coming from Just Food. So the first year was our big opportunity, really, with that 23,500 pounds that came in. And there was some miscommunication among staff about how to manage that on site. So it successfully was transported from Just Food with no flaws, no problems, no contamination even, over to the windrow where it was put into. And there was a lot of data that was collected. And as we found out later, in fact, it wasn't even that long ago this year, that they weren't turning the piles on time. And so it was really late, and the data was considered not very sufficient. And certainly not sufficient for what they needed. And so they were looking forward to the next year to remedy what went wrong. And then we didn't have any more food waste come in. We couldn't figure out the transportation issue. And they definitely did not want to do anything with the permit to make it go beyond fruit and veggies. I think that's probably the best way I can answer it. I know that they wanted to see if adding food waste to those windrows, including all of the windrows even, could provide the source of moisture that they really did need to make those the composting process happen over the winter when there's not grass clippings coming in. I don't know how much you know about that, but there's a certain ratio of nitrogen to carbon that you have to have, and to make the process happen, and moisture, of course, is really important. And grass clippings provide that during the spring and the summer. They don't do that in the winter. So the piles just kind of sit there and stall out during the winter. So it was a good pilot for that reason, but we really needed a lot more, open-mindedness or more opportunity to really look at something a little bit beyond fruit and veggies, maybe just a little bit, because there just wasn't anybody else in the community who could fill that void that Just Food was doing so gracefully.
So I think, thank you, Jamie.
Sure.
You reminded me. No, the limitations that we had on it. This may, in fact, answer the original question, which was, if I am paraphrasing that, how did the city feel about it ending? And so their, my understanding is their main goal of getting into it was to learn, and learn from that data and from the experiment. And when there was nothing to learn from, and we were limited to a narrow scope of which to stretch our learning, there wasn't really much of a choice. Does that make sense?
So everything along this hierarchy are things that my family is committed to and work on very hard. And I've lived in a community where when we lived in Germany and all of your waste is segregated when you live in the city to what can be composted, what can be recycled and so on. And so the city actually collected compost. And so I know that's for a community to get to that point, there are a lot of steps in between. So this pilot project is exciting to just find out like, can we physically handle the waste when it comes to the to the composting facility and then kind of work backwards from there. So just, I know that that's many steps between here and there. I just wondered if there are any kind of ongoing thoughts about working with trash collection agencies to see if that is something in the future.
Yeah, at this time, I don't think the city has, I haven't heard about the city having plans to go forward with anything else on this, but there are commercial businesses that offer curbside pickup, and through the pilot, we were able to work out, and we were able to assist and make it possible for someone to set up at the farmer's market and do a bucket swap program, so anybody can take part in that, and it's pretty affordable.
Oh, sorry. I think we've got Common Ground stuff up next. I was just speaking to staff.
Hi. So as Kim introduced me earlier, I am the Common Ground Program Manager. I've been so since March. And one of the neat things about my position is I am the first ever program manager for Common Ground. It has existed since 2012 on a fairly volunteer-based autonomous structure that was joint city and county effort. And this is the NRCS grant that made my position possible for the next 3 years that will allow a dedicated full-time staff person to bring a little bit more cohesion into the program, hopefully do some future visioning. Definitely since it's an NRCS grant, equity and conservation are two big angles. So again, my focus is going to try to expand our services to the underserved populations of Florence and also increase one of the other barriers that most underserved people have, which is right next to land, is education and technical assistance. So my job is trifold in that one third of the time I try to develop a strategy for the program and try to make them more sustainable. One third of the time I'm actually out in the field providing direct assistance to gardeners and farmers. And the other time I just spend doing educational workshops, which is, there were six pre-selected conservation technique subjects, and we have a little bit of flexibility moving them around. And since I am such a personal monarch butterfly fangirl, I was able to move it to be my first workshop for this year. That was early in June, and we got to partner with KU Monarch Watch for that. It was a great time. This year so far, I have put in about 50 hours of direct assistance. My grant was requiring about 33 per year, and I knew I was going to blow it out of proportion. So 50 hours going, I imagine somewhere around 60, 75 by the end of the year. Next one will be Incubator Farm. So yeah, for those of you that may not be totally familiar with the program, it has a total of 11, hopefully, as of this week, sites. 10 gardens and one incubator farm. This is one of our great KU Super Service Saturdays that we did earlier this year with the KU kiddos who came out to the farm for volunteer day. But we also are starting a farmer apprenticeship program with my grant. We have hired a very experienced curriculum developer, farmer himself, Panta Flores III. Some of you might know him and his expertise. So we are pretty much 50% through the drafting process. Curriculum will do in late winter. And then we're gonna look at hiring apprentices. Again, the priority is going to be very much on perhaps going out to Haskell for some more indigenous farmers, reaching out to some other underserved community members and expanding our reach as far as the farm footprint goes, which is exciting news. We were able to add Indigenous Community Center as one of our farmers this year. They have a full acre. And it's really neat because they have been super organized with their volunteer days and have been bringing such a big community from Haskell, which I love seeing every weekend. So they're, of course, very focused on Indigenous farmer methods and native plants and all that. Then the next one is, this is the exciting breaking news. That bottom photo I took yesterday afternoon at Broken Arrow Park. This is yet another grant that was a partnership with the Lawrence Douglas County Public Health. They actually got that through KDHE's Chronic Disease Risk Reduction program, which allowed us to add a common ground garden to Broken Arrow, which we broke ground literally yesterday, and that's why I'm covered in mud. So that's going to be a great partnership that took a lot of serious community outreach, surveying, kind of similar methods that Jamie and Kim had used in climate action planning. Is that there was a lot of, we inverted the system where instead of going to the public and saying, here's your new garden, we actually tried to go out to the community and said, okay, where do you think Common Ground needs another garden? And not everybody was happy, but this is what I've learned in the last 6 months as a public servant, is that I can't please everyone all of the time. So we're hoping that Broken Arrow will be a nice compromise for all of the people who really wanted more Western and Southern gardens. But this is about as South as we've been. So I think this will make certain people happy. And as Jamie mentioned, that pilot project, we are going to grab that last of the food compost from the city that was going to happen today. But we didn't get the beds built in time. We just finished the beds right before I ran over here. So those are two ADA beds that we built yesterday, the taller ones, and then two communal beds. And then to the south of them, we have 10 individual plots that will be available to the public. And I've also done a lot of outreach events. I'm really trying to get our name and brand out there. I want people to know about us more. I don't want it to be this closely guarded, super secret gardening club that, you know, we want to open it up to the community. So I've been very happy to do as many tabling events and outreach as possible. And we're also celebrating our 10th anniversary this year. We've already had one potluck. We have a fall harvest potluck coming up. And I know there's all sorts of weird like procedures that we're supposed to do, but I'm going to go ahead and break all of them and say, we would love to have you at our potluck if you could come. Something.
Always invite us to food.
Okay, good. There will be so much food. It'll be all local garden produce from the garden. So we hope that you can join us.
Thank you, Moot. I have a couple of questions. So all 11 of the gardens are predominantly food producing, right?
Is correct.
That, yeah. And so in their mixture of individual plots and communal beds, that are those communal beds, are they just available for anybody to come pick right. food, harvest if it's right. available?
Unfortunately, not all of the gardens have communal beds, but okay. most of them do. And that's one of the areas where we are trying to educate the public on the difference between, hey, this is somebody's actual yep. plot versus this is where if you're in need of produce, definitely go there. So I'm working on some educational materials to maybe post at the garden sites to make that process a little smoother.
Okay, cool. And then at Broken Arrow Park, so there's lots of landowners over on that corner. Is this in the city-owned parkland, or is this happen to be on county-owned
property? This is our first county-owned common okay. ground garden.
Even though it's, you know, it's yes. just a weird little county.
Broken Arrow is actually super interesting. Broken Arrow is a three-landlord park between the school system. So the school system is on the northern end. The city's in the middle. We have the south end. Those beds, if you're familiar with the Wakarusa Township stations, I'm not next to the big fire station, but it's the smaller shop building because they had a hydrant there and the Wakarusa Township folks were very nice and they're gonna let us use the water, which was huge.
And I just emailed Kim and Amut this, that I've had some very initial conversations with the city of Lawrence because they that we might, there might only be two landowners in the future at that site, that it might be a way the city might be willing to sort of take over some management of that moving forward. So hopefully we can have some simplicity there.
And that's a good lead into, I'm wondering, so the incubator farm otherwise is the only one that's outside the city limits of Lawrence, right?
It's actually still technically city really property.
Maple Grove, because it's next to the cemetery. Yep, thank you. That's just my bad. I tend to think of that as the dividing line, but you're right, it's not. So to that end, we don't have any outside the city limits of Lawrence other than this.
We don't yet.
Okay.
And that would be in our future strategizing, visioning. That's definitely something that we want to look into, is expanding into our smaller Douglas County communities and getting our footprint out there.
Cool. Perfect. And then will you just expand a little bit more on the farmer apprenticeship program? Because I'm very excited to hear that and would just like to kind of understand what the, I know it's I'm sure a development phase still, but like kind of what the primary goals for having rolling that position into the offices work.
Right. Again, it's just when you look at study after study into what are the challenges to get into farming for people that don't come from big landowner families, is that the first step is land. The second step is education. And then you have the tools and the cost of actual farming. But this apprenticeship program is specifically designed to help beginning farmers. So we're looking at people who might consider going into agriculture as a career and might want to really get the beginning farmer operation down. So they will be shadowing a couple of our farmers. There are going to be two next year and two following years. So each apprentice is going to be assigned to a farmer that they will shadow. They'll put in, I believe, about 10 hours of work at the farm. Plus they will be following Ponta's curriculum, going through the steps. So Ponta and I will be on the education side, literally just teaching them how to do it. And then they will have the hands-on shadowing experience with the individual farmers.
Wonderful. I'm excited about that. Thank you.
I am too. Thank you.
I am really small. Okay, I think I want to do that. Great. Like Kim had mentioned before, I have been part of the food system organizing and planning for a few years. So I was part of creating the food system plan about 5-6 years ago, I would say. And I have also been a food council member and really pushed forward the work in regards to cultural and racial equity through my time here in the county, and also as a staff in the sustainability office. And now my new role, I believe it's been a month, maybe. I am, wow, okay, it does. I am supporting the Douglas County Food Council in advancing the food plan for the next, because right now we are entering the next half of a 10-year plan. So we are at year 5 and it's a 10-year plan. So there's a lot coming. Right now, the Douglas County Food Policy Council has 2 members, Cody Haynes and Ryan Barson, who are currently in the John Hopkins Center for Livable Future Equity Cohort. And they're spending some time learning about how food councils can push forward on equity, in particular cultural and racial equity as well. And what is exciting about that is that they are bringing all of these new systems and learnings to the council to push forward equity, not just in a small section of the food plan, which is the goal, which is the goal 4, I believe, focuses on equity, but focusing on equity in all the sections of the food plan. So in growing, transportation, buying, et cetera. So that's really exciting to think about that focus on equity in all of the food system. Something else that is exciting that has just been published is the dashboard. So we have recently published dashboard that shares a lot of data from several sources, including the farmer census, which is actually going to be updated within a few months. And this information is going to be shared to the public. Right now it's live. It's a website that it's live. And there is data for each goal in the food system plan. So we have 5 goals. And when you click on it, you will find correlating data for each goal. And the goal of all of creating all of this work and putting it together is to convene, well, the Douglas County Food Policy Council plans to convene food system leaders of all sectors and look through this data together and see where we have been from the past 5 years. If you could put the next slide. So for example, one of our indicators showing here from 2010 to 2019, the total organic produce sales in US dollars. So you can see an increase of interest and sales. And when we are looking at this all together in a group of food system leaders, everyone from food banks to farmers to consumers, et cetera, we can collectively think about what does this mean? What kind of policies we can support and what kind, how to move forward in the next 5 years of the food plan. To wrap it up, we are jumping into the next half of the food plan with a lot of support and a really big direction towards equity and sustaining a system. Yes.
So that was our overview for you. And we'd love to hear what additional questions you have or things that you didn't see here that you want to know if we're thinking about or looking into.
This is very exciting work, and I'm glad for the update, and I'm sure pester you with questions as the months unfold. One thing I'd like to just have a quick discussion or see what directions are being looked into for the climate action plan would be about our energy footprint and like what the goals are for kind of community-wide, like how much electricity are we expecting to need? How much do we generate now? What are some of the changing footprints available to us and what's our vision to get to? I think having a big picture goal will help us kind of make some of the decisions that may come before this commission before too long.
Yeah, that's a great question. We did leave out a detail and that is we do not have a greenhouse gas inventory for the entire county, but that is something we're actively pursuing that we want to have in hand to inform our plan. And so I think having that data is going to help us to include the strategies that you're citing in our plan.
Kim, this may be a later presentation, but I know there's lots of people in our community who are very excited to hear about the open space plan. And you said that was part of your responsibilities. Can you at least give us maybe an update or schedule or when they might hear more about that?
Yes. So as soon as we are able to have a convening with our selected consultant, that is when we as a team will actually map out the next steps. And once we do have those steps, we will think about where what's the point in time that we're like, hey, public, we're coming. And so I imagine that once we have those steps and feel very confident in that, that we will want to let the community know within the fall.
And I think even in advance of that, not just like how the public can engage in that process, but how is the commission, what's our plan? So I think like once you kind of get your bearings underneath you with the consultant and the team, like I think just sharing that whole process and sort of, because I think we just need to define better this is a huge tent is what I keep saying in terms of open space. And you know, what's inside that tent, you know, to preview the work ahead in terms of the process.
Absolutely. And we'd be happy, our open space team, to come back and do another work session with you when we do have our work plan and our timeline, so we can get into that detail with you, because the tent Sarah mentioned, and which I failed to, is, you know, we're going to be looking at, you know, what are the values around land for our community? We're talking about cultural significance, agriculture, conservation, floodplain, climate mitigation, recreation, you know, all of those things are going to be in the tent, and we're going to have to figure out where our values are guiding us.
Question. I mean, one of our big charges is policy. I saw policy on there, and we have a unique opportunity that's about to hit us with the Panasonic plant out in Johnson County. And I expect that there will be implications here in Douglas County when that plant comes, or maybe even before it gets there. Have you all thought about, from your role in the sustainability office, policy recommendations or thoughts on how you might support the decision-making we do in regards to sustainability and the impacts of that Panasonic plant coming?
I think that where my mind goes, I think a lot of that's going to come into land and development. And so we'll be looking to our guiding commitments when those questions come up, our food system plan, plan 2040, the priorities that are developing as part of our open space plan, what we know about climate risks and what's showing up in land use with that. So I think those are the tools right off the bat that we would want to hold up for you and make part of the conversation.
I think that's a really great question, Commissioner Kelly, in terms of, you know, one of the things I'm really proud of about our sustainability efforts is how we really integrate this work into a lot of different areas of county government. It's not, you know, cordoned off in and of itself and separated, and particularly the, you know, the work happening in open space is really a blending here of land use, heritage, and sustainability work. And so I think, like, how as we begin to see the challenges that come before our community, and I do think you're right, I think they will primarily face us in land use, but even with the types of industries and suppliers, like, you know, I think we will need to have some conversations about what it says for our community and how do we best, you know, how are we completely thoughtful and thinking about, you know, seven generations as to the impact of this stuff. So I appreciate the question, Commissioner Kelly, and, you know, I think it'd just be ongoing deliberation and conversation for all of us, and hope the commission will continue to hold us accountable and think about as we can find those opportunities to strengthen your all's leadership in that space, that it's something staff can help support you on.
I just want to add a little bit to that, because I also think it's a wonderful question, and we definitely do have our eyes on it. I just wanted to add that in the Climate Action Plan, we're so fortunate to have the staff advisory, which Bill Jellicoe is a member of as well. And we have a steering committee, and on those committees, there are folks that will be adding more content to this conversation as well, around economic development in particular is one that I'm really looking at. Green jobs, you know, this is a really big opportunity for that. So it's our office isn't making all the decisions alone, looking to these other plans, and then also pulling in all this expertise from the area.
Yeah, I'm glad you said green jobs. And I think it just creates a unique, and maybe it's not going to be unique much longer, right? In this idea that in order to sustain our communities with enough energy, we're going to have to look to different resources. But in order to do that, we may have to lose some resource, you know. So how do we find the space in there between those two things? You know, a battery plant probably is good long term, right? As we think about sustainable energy. However, the space that it will take to house people who work at that plant and the space for those industries is going to maybe eat in a little bit to it. We've seen some with solar. I mean, that's another one that comes up a lot. And I would encourage this group, since you asked sort of what our is not to wait for that conversation to come to you, but to get engaged in that conversation early on, and be open in those conversations. So.
I appreciate this discussion, and I think that well, there's an opportunity in the fact that the office has been restructured so that it is Douglas County focus. And to your point at the beginning, Kim, about the climate action plan being Douglas County wide in order to be inclusive of all four cities and everywhere in between, sort of the opportunity there with Panasonic coming, in particular, the impact that it's going to have on Eudora and the surrounding areas of Eudora. And so the opportunities in relationships that you're building with those other communities that maybe haven't been as strong or existent about different types of city municipal policies that are relevant to the growth of their cities, you know, annexation, industries that might be interested in submitting permit applications. Some of them might happen in the unincorporated area, but more than likely those industrial type uses are going to be happening through cities, city planning commissions and city commissions. And so talking about the types of industries and the potential harms or the potential benefits for sustainable energy and environmental impact of those. Because yeah, it's gonna be both residential growth and business growth that are gonna be the ripple effect of that. And Eudora's proximity, in my opinion, means that it's gonna have the most pressure for them to grow their boundaries and also potentially be, in addition to DeSoto and other places in Johnson County, the place where other industries that wanna support this battery plant are coming to. So, yeah, I appreciate that question and think that there's lots of different opportunities and ways to sort of infuse education and information about how to update policies, both at the county level, but how we might be able to provide information to those other cities as they're thinking about what growth looks like for them. I have a question to go back to for you, Connie, about the food system plan. And I know that I'm excited about the website being live and that there's a place to keep publishing that data and putting it out there and putting it into context. And that I really liked that graphic of all the different places that touch the food system and all the different types of jobs and sectors and parts of the supply chain. Where am I going with this question? There's a lot of questions in my head, to be honest. I'm kind of trying to pick one. I'm curious about what kind of, and maybe the opportunities through the food policy council members that are working through that John Hopkins program, like really help us figure out how to localize things in a way that does not rely on the regional and national and global supply chain that so much lies on. And so I think a lot about that and how, here's my question in this. I'm just wondering, and maybe that's about to really ramp up in this later half of the food system plan, how to really like figure out where the gaps are in the supply chain of food, both fruits, vegetables, meat, grains, those things, what is locally produced and stays here versus leaving here. And my other thought about that is just that I love the focus on the smaller grocers and the ethnic focused BIPOC grocers that we have and highlighting that. And also I think about where are they sourcing their food and what kind of access do they have to local produce and local meats to be able to sourcing their grocery stores with that, or is it even affordable?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I have also been thinking about that. And I know that Food Council has too. For example, we had the ethnic retailer study in 2019 that showed that all of the ethnic retailers in Lawrence want to have local produce and want to have fresh produce and meats. The barrier for that is farmers growing those specialty produce, like jicama or nopales or each of their culture, which do grow here. They don't need to be imported thousands of miles across the sea to come to these stores. You know, you can still have the cultural foods that you need and have them grown here. So I think we are thinking about those system barriers, such as finding one, land, and two, farmers that are knowledgeable on how to grow these specialty crops. and expanding that to other grocers too. So thinking about what the needs are first. And of course, land is very integral to growing, and it's not just land, it's also infrastructure. So you can be a farmer and with land and water, but if you don't have proper refrigeration, then the majority of it will go to waste. You know, there's a lot of infrastructure that you need to be successful.
And competitive, I might add. I mean, that's the other thing when I'm looking at it from the perspective of my incubator farmer, beginner farmers. Again, as Connie pointed out, yes, we have 5 acres there that's being shared by 10 farmers, and we have a tool shed, but they don't have bathrooms, they don't have refrigeration, they don't have some of the high-level tools that are really costly. So it's just, there's so much need out there. So when we look at the entire picture of the food system, there are different ways we can support the community and these people who are really wanting to go into farming, and how we can support them policy-wise to accomplish these wider food system plan goals.
Yeah, I think it's also intertwined with access to land and the price of it. And also good quality soil or dirt. So thinking about those intertwined with green jobs is like thinking about where those green jobs are placed in the soil quality, where they can be otherwise be used for farming to have local produce of all cultures grown here.
Yes, well, on that note, I'll say for the record that I'm very hopeful and interested in part of the open space plan, that land acquisition is a natural part of that for a variety of different reasons, sort of to be determined. But I hope that part of that is that land can be acquired and owned in a way that keeps it in food production in perpetuity, that is food production for the local community. To help fill in some of the gap of, I mean, Commissioner Kelly and I both remember from our budget hearings earlier this summer and our ARPA discussions in particular, a request from Just Food for ARPA dollars, which we were really focused on being one-time investments that didn't have ongoing costs. They needed some an expansion of their parking lot, and they also had significant amount of food that they are unable to purchase and unable to acquire because of the rising cost, the rising need, all of those things. And even though gleaning programs have helped fill some of that stopgap, they aren't producing locally enough to help feed that system, both for food donation and market, food to market. So I'm really hopeful about the possibility of that, and having farmers that are working to produce food for the public of our community. I'm also very interested in compost toilets at our county parks and the county incubator farm, perhaps. So just don't know, you know, there's all sorts of code issues. I can have a discussion with our zoning and codes office, but big fan of compost toilets. Think that they're an appropriate solution for us to consider as we're thinking about opening up more public space out in the unincorporated parts of the county.
I'm going to be on the lookout, and I am very excited about the possibility of discovering intersections between flood mitigation, agriculture, land access, large-scale solar, and agrivoltaics. And where's the marriage of all of those things so that we're getting the most use out of that land, but also, you know, researching growing different types of food with solar panels so that we can be a leader in that regard. So I'm with you, Shannon.
Any other questions or thoughts from commissioners? Do you all have any closing thoughts that are bumping around in your head before we conclude? Okay, thank you all so much for being here. I've really been looking forward to this and super excited about the things to come, and really believe that the reorganization of things is gonna mean big and great things for our county at large. So I appreciate that focus and appreciate everything y'all are doing. Have a good evening.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Adjourned until our 5:30 business meeting.